Turn with me in your Bibles to Philippians 4 and 8. And while you're turning, I'll pray. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we just want to say thank you, God. Thank you for everything that you're doing for us and everything that you're yet about to do. God, I just want to say thank you for having us have the mind to always seek you first, to want to be at church, to want to grow in your word, to want to know more. God, please touch our pastor from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet, God. Make his mind good at all times, God. Renew him at all times. Give him the strength of 10 men. God, we thank you for this man, and we cannot thank you enough, God. Thank you for this church. Thank you for everyone that works in our church, God. Thank you for the children, God, and we thank you for everything that you're doing for us. God, I act that I decrease and that you increase. In your son Jesus' name, amen. Philippians 4 and 8. Philippians 4 and 8. It says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Tonight my title is, you have to control your thoughts. August 2017, Psychology Today printed an article that focused on three negative thinking patterns to avoid. The first pattern was called negative rumination. Rumination is a kind of negative thinking in which we get mentally stuck and keep spinning our wheels without making progress, like a car stuck in the mud. Rumination can make you more and more anxious as you keep thinking of more and more negative outcomes that could possibly happen. 2 Thessalonians 2:11 says, and for this cause, God shall send them strong delusions that they should believe a lie. Rumination is a negative mindset that keeps us bound with worry. The utility bill is overdue. If I can't pay the utility bill, I won't have any lights. If I don't have any lights, if they cut off the lights, they're going to cut off the water. If they cut off the water, I can't feed the children. If I can't feed the children, CPS going to get involved. If CPS get involved, they're going to take my children. If they take my children, oh my God, I don't know what I'm going to do. You thought all this up over the utility bill is due. You ain't called, you haven't tried to make any arrangements. All of this came from just the bill being due. Rumination is when one negative thought builds on another and it just goes out of hand. You have to learn how to control your thoughts. The second pattern to avoid is overthinking. Overthinking is when you go over and over different choices in your mind, trying to imagine every possible outcome and everything that could happen in the future to make sure that you make a perfect choice. The problem with overthinking is that it attempts to control the uncontrollable. Philippians 4, 6, and 7 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with the thanksgiving of your requests, be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. See, I want a new job. I get the job. So now I'm worrying about where I'm going to park my car. I'm worrying about if this boss going to act like the last boss. I'm worrying about if the people going to like me at the job. I'm worrying about things that I cannot control. I don't even know anything yet. I got the new job. Why am I overthinking this process? All of these things are uncontrollable at the time. Why do you let things bother you? You made up all of these scenarios in your head. See, rumination is different from overthinking. In that rumination, we know the things that can actually happen. In overthinking, these are just scenarios that we play out in our head and make situations up that we cannot control. You got to learn how to control your thoughts. The third thinking pattern that we need to avoid is cynical hostility. Cynical hostility is a way of thinking and reacting that is characterized by angry mistrust of other people. You see other people as threats. They might cheat you. They might take advantage of you. They might let you down. They might deceive you or otherwise cause you harm. Cynical hostility involves interpreting others' actions as something against you. James 1, 19 and 20 says, "Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of a man worketh not the righteousness of God." A person that is blinded by cynical hostility sees every act as a way we are trying to get them. I'm in my car. I'm driving behind you. You driving the speed limit. I'm in a rush. You doing it on purpose. You purposely going slow so I can't get to where I'm trying to be. That's how they are. You know that's what they doing. She doing it on purpose. Person don't even know me. I'm just driving the speed limit. You the one left late. Why is all this attitude coming toward me? It's an attitude. Girl, she done hugged me 3 times. Pastor kind of said, go and hug 3 people. I wonder what she up to, girl. She done hugged me 3 times. She done, I promise you, she hugged me when I came in the door. She hugged me when the pastor said hug somebody. And just a few minutes ago, girl, when Minister Williams said hug somebody, she found me again. She came and hugged me, girl. She up to something. She is up to something. Cynical hostility. Cynical hostility. The whole time Pastor Kind was preaching, he was looking at me. He was looking at me the whole time. Somebody telling all my business to that man. I can't stand when folks get up in your business. Really? Do y'all really think the pastor kind of lay out and say, well, today I'm going to preach just to Penny. And I'm just going to tell her about herself. I'm going to get on her so that she'll know, you know. Because you're going to get this thing right. Cynical hostility. Cynicism leads to bitterness. Bitterness leads to loneliness. Loneliness leads to depression. Depression leads to suicide. Could it be that we're thinking ourselves to death? Now that we know the negative thinking patterns that we must avoid, how do we make our minds think the right thing? Proverbs 23 and 7 says, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." I know you are saying to yourself, I can't control what I think, but you got to discipline your thoughts. You discipline your thoughts the same way you discipline a child. The first thing you do is you pay attention to what you're thinking. When raising children, you have to give them a certain amount of attention. If you're not giving a child attention, you're not raising that child. So I don't want you to think because I fed them, I clothed them, I made sure that, you know, he got to school on time. That's not all raising is. Raising a child is giving them attention. When Pastor Kiner said today, I stopped and I had a teachable moment with those boys. That's raising a child. Raising a child is paying attention to the child, stepping in, saying things at the right time. So that's why we always say, although he pays child support, he's a deadbeat dad. He's a deadbeat dad because this child don't know him. He don't have an emotional connection with him. He has nothing. There's nothing about him that stands out. You heard Tupac say, "The man died, and I couldn't even feel for a stranger as I stood over his grave." Man, I don't even know this man. They call him my daddy, but he wasn't nothing to me. Just because you father or mother somebody don't make you a parent. You have to treat your mind the same way you should treat your children. Your mind is no different. You have to pay attention to what you are thinking. You have to be invested in changing the negative thought patterns. In order to do this, you have to support your thought process with positive thinking, positive mantras, and positive outcomes. 1 Peter 5 and 8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour." Philippians 4 and 8 says, "Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things." Number 2, take the time to train your thoughts. Just like when you're training a child, you have to remember that the word discipline is rooted in teaching and learning. Training your thoughts is no different than training your children. How to behave, how to clean, how to share. At school, we call it explicit direct instruction. First, I do it, I model it. Then we do it together. That means we're working on it together. Then they do it. When I say they, 2 or more children are working together to get it done. then they're able to independently do it. You have to teach your mind to work in that way. Our thoughts need training. We need to model what we think. Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Then we need to work on refocusing our negative thoughts to the things in Philippians 4:8. This is twofold. See, in my class, I told you to take two students to come and be the they do. You are your own they do. You have to start talking to yourself. I told you, when I talk to myself, I call myself by my name. I say, Penny, girl. So you have to tell yourself. You have to be like, Penny, girl, what's going on? What you thinking about this for? Why is this even on your mind? Penny, girl, you ain't got nothing else to think about? Really? Your mind don't have anything else to do? This is times where you have to start telling yourself, this don't even make no sense. We are going to have to ask ourselves some questions. When these crazy thoughts appear, we're going to have to ask ourselves, is this true? Is this honest? Is this just? How do we keep our thoughts pure for ourselves? Are my thoughts tainted by the outside interference? How to keep my thoughts lovely? I have to ask myself to think positive thoughts. Are my thoughts of good report? Does this make me a better person? Does this build me up? Ultimately, can I find a way to put a praise on it? While we are training our minds, until we are independently think the right thoughts, we will have to talk to ourselves. Until those thoughts become what we are teaching them to be. We will know that we have gotten there when someone approaches us with gossip and we tell them, you know what, we just gonna pray about this thing. Girl, I think she's doing the best that she can do. Then I know I done trained my thoughts, because how is this gonna work out? Girl, we gonna pray about it. We gonna work on, let's go see, can we help her? You think that's really what's going on? Let's go see, can we help her? Are you really thinking just thoughts? Number three, be consistent and be careful. When raising children, it's important to set boundaries and stick to them. Make sure that the consequences fit the crime. 2 weeks without your cell phone don't fit the crime of not washing dishes one night. What's your purpose? I forgot one night. Okay, wake me up. Make me get up. I missed some sleep. That's what my mama did, baby. She didn't care what time. She walked through that kitchen, she'd be like, hey, get in there and clean my kitchen. I missed some sleep because I didn't do what I was supposed to do. You don't take my cell phone for 2 weeks. Don't y'all know when y'all take them cell phones, y'all doing something to them children? Them children go through some kind of withdrawal when y'all take their phones. It ain't worth it. It don't even meet. I am used to checking people. If y'all don't know what checking is, that's when you, now I'm just going to be honest, y'all. Y'all know people walk past you, you be like, really? She ain't see a mirror? Them shoes and that shirt, thank God. Ooh, Jesus, I'm going to pray for her. You praying for her shoes and shirt? Get your life. Because you used to doing crazy stuff. For those of you that don't know it, it's just something that you can do at all times. Kids do it all the time, but we are not children. We're adults. So we have to get our lives together. So what am I going to do in order to combat this thought process? I have to first recognize petty thoughts. Then I have to make a conscious decision to think of something else. The easiest way to think of other things is to put it out of my mind, find better communication. Lastly, since I know that I have a petty thought process, I have to consciously tell myself, this doesn't make any sense for me to be thinking about it. Psalms 19:14 says that the words of my mouth in the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In closing, and I do mean in closing, I'm going to give you three scriptures that you're going to read on your own that's going to help you retrain your thought process. The first scripture that I'm going to give you is 2 Corinthians 10:5. The second one is Isaiah 26 and 3. The third one is Philippians 2 and 5. In order to make your mind think the right thoughts, you have to make sure that you focus, your focus is not on carnal things. Place your focus on drawing closer to God. You have to control your thoughts.